The World Health Organization today reported the single largest daily increase in coronavirus cases, more than 183,000 new infections. Here, there were two new cases from the latest batch of Kiwis who have returned home. As yet, of course, there is no return to community transmission. After a messy week, the government today announced further restrictions on travellers arriving back in Aotearoa. And I asked Health Minister David Clark why sick people are being allowed on planes in the first place.
Well, of course, the responsibility for people getting onto planes rests on the other side of the equation. It's not expected that sick people will be allowed on planes, and certainly I know Air New Zealand's taken a very strong stance around that. Of course, these are also New Zealanders who have a right to return home. But we also have expectations that they will take personal responsibility and will not fly if they're unwell.
How is this happening?
Well, that's a question that I want to hear more answers to be frank.
What have you heard so far?
So far we've heard that this has happened in the last week. It does seem that some people may have got onto airplanes that weren't well. I'm wanting more follow-up on to understand how that could have happened overseas and what more can be done to make sure it doesn't happen.
Where does the airline's responsibility for them?
Well, the airline is responsible for making sure that people don't get on there.
So how's it happening?
So that's exactly the question. It's not happening within New Zealand. I want to be sure it's not happening with other airlines, but as I say, these things have to be handled carefully and they have to be got right.
Does that mean that airlines haven't been taking sufficient precautions up to this point?
Well, I think what we've seen is that actually New Zealand's leading the pack globally in terms of what we've got here, but that our border is the critical thing that we've got to get right. And so we have spotted in the last period, in the last week, some challenges at our borders, and we are working to fix those things, as we have the whole way through the COVID response. You know, when we didn't get PPE going through to our NGOs or our private providers, the government stepped in, set up a national distribution system. When we had low testing equipment, we stepped in and made sure that we now have the highest testing numbers per positive case in the world. We've moved wherever we've identified a problem, and now we're seeing at our borders, we've got those challenges and we're moving to fix them.
I mean, this was a predictable problem, wasn't it? That as soon as we started letting more people into the country, regardless of whether or not they are New Zealanders, we might have issues with people bringing COVID-19 into the country.
Absolutely. Our global rates are at their highest level, 183,000 cases globally yesterday. And I think there's a risk that as New Zealanders, we might have been getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, that long string of zeros and the sense that in New Zealand we'd knocked out community transmission. It's really important that we stay on top of
things. So you're satisfied with Air New Zealand, but what about the other airlines that are flying to New Zealand?
Well, those are the exactly the questions. There is an expectation that they do the right thing. This is only just coming to light, and those conversations are happening now. I won't say any more about it here today.
You're meeting with Air New Zealand tonight. What will your message be?
My message to them will be, firstly, thank you for the steps that they have taken, but I also want to have a conversation about how we progress from here, how we continue to shore things up.
What do you mean by that?
Well, what other steps can be taken? We're going to be encouraging use of PPE on flights. Up until now, that's been an optional thing. We think that it would be good if all people on flights would be using PPE. The crew certainly are. We don't have evidence of any transmission happening on the plane, so it looks like things are working well now, but we can always do better.
Are you satisfied with New Zealand's crewing rosters, that people who potentially have exposure to individuals who are COVID-19 positive aren't then moving about in a level one New Zealand potentially spreading?
Well, I think we do have to acknowledge that to date we've seen no evidence of that, and credit to Air New Zealand and the way that they have been applying those strictures that they have in place. Certainly for their overseas travel, they have some very strict protocols around it, and that's appropriate. And those have been updated as we've gone through, and I would expect that we want to review them and keep updating them.
The Prime Minister has said today a new health order will come into force this evening that will require individuals to submit to testing before they leave quarantine. Why wasn't this in place before now?
Look, it was a clear expectation on the 9th of June as we moved to a level one. It was absolutely there for all to see that we would have people tested.
I mean, this is a law now.
It is. It's in the health order, just to make it crystal clear, but it was also the expectation beforehand. We've seen with the two women who came back from the UK that protocol wasn't strictly followed. Again, I moved immediately to suspend compassionate leave until we have confidence in the system. Moving early and moving decisively has served us well throughout this whole pandemic, and I don't make any apology for that.
So June 9th is when the requirement came in. How often from that point did you request updates from your officials hospitals and quarantining facilities as to the number of people in quarantine being tested?
Look, I had no reason to believe, because I had certainly reassurances that this was happening, any sense that it wasn't.
And so, how often specifically did you request those updates?
Look, honestly, Jack, I have subsequently learnt that this wasn't happening. I had no reason to believe it wasn't. That was an operational requirement. Ashley Bloomfield has apologised because he himself believed that that was happening in the system.
You, as the Minister of Health, how often did you...
Well,
your job is to...
I certainly sought assurances it was happening.
Okay, so how often...
I haven't made a list of every time I've asked every question.
Well, shouldn't... isn't that a basic requirement?
You wouldn't expect me to.
No, I think people would expect you to.
Every question that I ask the Director General, whom I talk to several times a day...
If you were to look at New Zealand's borders and identify the areas where we were most vulnerable to a COVID-19 outbreak, expecting regular updates as to the number of people who just arrived in New Zealand being tested... is a basic requirement.
Well, I'd push back on that. Globally, we're leading the pack here in the COVID response.
When we identified a problem,
we've moved immediately to fix it.
I'm just going to ask you one more time, though. From that period on June 9th until now, how often would you have asked the Director General of Health or your other senior health officials the number of people being tested
in
quarantine?
I'm going to repeat myself and say I don't have a list of the number of times I've asked. I sought assurances, I received them. The Director General
did
believed
you ask it all?
Was happening. The Director General believed it was happening when I sought his assurance, and the system has failed in this instance, and that's why we've moved to fix it, because as you identify, this is critical to get right. We cannot afford to be complacent. As a country, people have made a lot of sacrifices. We are leading the pack. We've got to continue to lead
the pack. Some people will interpret that level of scrutiny or lack thereof as complacency. So let me ask this. We have seen in the last few days other people being brought in to take over critical roles in this pandemic, the likes of Megan Woods and defence staff. What is your job at the moment in the COVID-19?
My job is the same as it was before, which is to ensure the health response is world-beating. And I think... the results show that it is. I'm very proud of the way our health system and the people in it have responded. We are the envy of the world right now. The important thing is we stay that way and we keep it that way.
Specifically, though, what do you do?
With the health system?
The response to COVID-19, what's your job?
My job is to make sure that the right things are happening across the system, that we're asking the right questions. It's a governance role.
What does that mean?
So, this evening I'll be meeting with Air New Zealand, for example, to check that their systems are as good as they can be and what other things are emerging from their perspective, how we can manage those things.
Your job is to be asking the right questions across the board.
That's right. And so, there's many questions every day in respect of COVID.
How many people have been tested in quarantine?
Exactly. And so that is now thoroughly being proofed, I can tell you. Once we've identified any mistake as a government, we have moved rapidly to fix it.
Was that era with the two women who'd arrived back from the UK, was that your responsibility?
Obviously, that's an operational thing, and that's how the Prime Minister's seen it as well. Cabinet was told these things were happening, so it was reasonable to expect.
You're the Minister with oversight, though. So do you take responsibility for that era, or is it your
official? It's an operational matter, and I think Dr. Bloomfield has apologised for it. But I would also say Dr. Bloomfield's done an exceptional job, I think, New Zealanders would recognise through this pandemic, and where a problem has been identified, he has moved to fix it.
When it comes to oversight, though, you are the Minister.
Look, honestly, there is a difference between oversight and delivery, and on this matter, Dr. Bloomfield accepted the system didn't deliver as it was expected to. He apologised, but he's fixing it.
In the initial response to COVID-19, you referenced this before, there were some well-publicised concerns from people on the front line about the supplies of PPE, the supplies of protective equipment. Now, the Auditor-General's report into PPE found the government didn't know how much stock it had in that initial response. But on March 27th, you said, quote, "We have good stocks." Why would you make that statement?
Look, I again was seeking assurances from the Director General through this, and I was assured that in a globally competitive environment we were doing well at getting stock.
But it's not around the country. But we're not looking at comparing ourselves in that context, are we? We're looking to make sure that everyone on the front line of this response has the appropriate equipment they need to stay safe. And the Auditor General found that wasn't the case. But you were telling us at the time it was.
At each stage I acted on the best advice that I had. And again, I would say the results speak for themselves. We are where we are, and it's also true that the most important thing was the messages that were being conveyed through the COVID campaign, personal hygiene measures, staying home when you're sick, washing your hands regularly. Those things are actually the first line of defence, and then also moving to set up a national distribution of PPE when we identified there were some challenges.
That's a significant discrepancy, though, isn't it? You've got people on the front line saying we don't have the gear, and you as Health Minister are saying we have good stocks.
Oh, well, that's when, as soon as we discovered issues, we moved into set up up a national distribution network, we fixed it.
I appreciate that responding to COVID-19 has been challenging, but you defied your own department's public health advice during the national lockdown. You and your officials gave misleading comments about national PPE supply. Two people with coronavirus were let out of quarantine without being tested, with you as minister. Why should you be the Minister for Health?
Oh, look, I apologise for the personal mistakes I made at the start of lockdown. My job has been to get on and do the job and make sure the system's working well. And I have no better explanation for why I should be Health Minister other than the results that we've got, where we are the envy of the world. The thing that I would say, though, is that's the result of New Zealanders' sacrifices, the people in the health system who've done a fantastic job, and we are the envy, but we've got to stay the envy of the world, and we do that by doing our job well.
Do you think you've done a good job?
Yes, I do.
Do you think you should be the Minister of Health after the election?
Look, I do. I think there's a huge opportunity in the health space. The Health and Disability Sector Review, which I commissioned, I hope we'll get a chance to talk about in this interview, is a document that really lays out an opportunity in the health system to make sure it's sustainable and delivering more equity for our populations. That's something that I commissioned and am absolutely determined to see followed through on.
Let's talk about the report. Will we see the change that the Simpson Port recommends?
The general direction has been signed up to already by the Cabinet. The implementation is going to require some working through. It's 264 pages long, full of recommendations. It reminds me just how complex that system is. Not an issue I haven't wrestled with in there before, but you lay them all together and you realise how complex and interdependent it is. Getting the implementation plan right is critical. Then there's legislation, which will be the job of the next government to pick through.
Some concern has already been raised over the inability under these recommendations for the public to elect members of their DHBs. What is your response to that? From a democratic perspective, is that worthy of concern?
Well, look, I think the most important thing is we actually have real democracy that works, and in the report there's a requirement going to be placed on DHBs to consult with their local communities, to develop plans with their local communities, which they just simply don't do now, to meet local need. In terms of getting rid of that elected function, I think the call for professional governance is right. I don't get a lot of people coming up to me on the street and saying, I'm really glad I had the chance to vote in the local DHB election, I know all the people, and it was really tough ranking the candidates. It's simply not the case. There are some really good people who are elected, and there are also some people who are not particularly suitable for election. And so the report suggests we make some change. Again, that'll go to the next government to make the decision.
So how soon? How? Give us a time frame. How quickly would
we see
change?
In terms of the elected...
To the recommendations in the report.
Those things will go into legislation. I would hope, if I was a part of an incoming government, I'd want to move relatively quickly, because I think the plan that's laid out in there is sensible.
And a year after presents, the election?
I would hope we'd be making progress by then, certainly. It suggests, for example, that in terms of diminishing the number of DHBs, which I think most people think is a good idea, that you first need to do the planning around providing services before you start thinking about the amalgamation. That's sensible. So things will be done step by step, but the opportunity is huge and it will make a real difference for New Zealanders, I believe.